Hey, John. Yes, I'm an adventurer. It's always an adventure to be a conservative in the 21st century. And my exploits hanging off of cliffs by my fingertips is always a good preparation for facing the political and social challenges of the moment. I'd like to thank David Quinn and the Iona Institute for inviting me, and I'd like to thank David for a wonderful day of hospitality here in Dublin. I do have ancestors from Ireland, but I have to report that they're the wrong kind. I'm the first Catholic I can identify in my family tree since the Reformation. So that tells you the bad guy, if you know what I mean. I don't want to talk so much about Trump. He'll figure somewhat in what I'm going to say tonight. Instead, I want to give a talk that provides a background, my interpretation of the political moment that we're in, because the Trump phenomenon is not unique. Brexit, there's going to be a vote in the Netherlands, there's going to be a vote in April and then May in France, Germany in September. And we had the vote in Italy just a couple of months ago. So there's something that's happening in the political culture of the West. And it's my conviction that it has a strong spiritual dimension. And so what I want to do is I want to give you a talk tonight that lays out my theory of where we are culturally and politically in the 21st century as a way of explaining, in effect, put Trump in context. I'll make some mention of Trump, and certainly during the Q&A, I'd be happy to entertain any questions. And I want to say something about the era in which we live that gave rise to Trump, and I want to then conclude by identifying what I think our task as Christians is in this particular moment, because I think it's a perilous one. So let me begin. Last fall, at First Things, I received an essay from a young man in Australia. He is in his mid to late 20s. And his essay ended with a very arresting sentence. And it read like this: "I am 27 years old and hope to live to see the end of the 20th century." Now, I sympathize with this sentiment of this young fellow, his desire to live to see the end of the 20th century. It's a paradoxical aspiration, given that we do live, after all, in the 21st century already. I'm going to lean in even more. I'm sympathetic because it seems to me we've reached a series of dead ends in the West. After the collapse of the Soviet Union, Americans thought that the world stage had been cleared, and such that our benevolent power could lift others to the bright uplands of liberal democracy and free market prosperity. That was what we all thought in America after 1989. The European Union seemed to move from strength to strength, positioning the nations of Europe as forerunners in a coming system of international cooperation and soft power. But these hoped for utopias have not come to pass. And what we once thought to be an inevitable benevolent future is being rejected and is leading to a rebellion. And not just from non-Western forces that resent our triumphalism, but within our own countries and among our own people. For good and for ill, it seems to me, the 20th century is finally ending. So I think that that's something I want to sort of explain what I think the 20th century was about and why it's ending. Now, one sure sign of the end of the 20th century is the collapse of the classic structure of modern Western politics, which since the Industrial Revolution has revolved around the diverging interests of labor and capital. This is particularly obvious, this collapse of the left-right distinction is particularly obvious in Europe, where establishment parties now cooperate nor defend off anti-establishment challenges. But this has become less and less effective, this coalition against the outsiders, as recent votes for Brexit and against the Italian constitutional reform indicate. Now, the constitutional system in my country militates against coalition governments, But our last presidential election featured an anti-Trump consensus among elites that transcended the traditional left-right distinctions. And again, as is the case in Europe, this establishment consensus failed to carry the day. So it seems that the wheel of history is turning. In this changing political environment, the central and most divisive issue is almost always the role and future of the nation state. Will we enter into the shining future of a prosperous, globalized fusion of civilization, managed by experts and guided by the high ideals of human rights? Is that going to be our future? Or will we return to the dark days of racism, nationalism, war, and concentration camps? Now, of course, to put this in this way is what is tendentious. Put in those terms, obviously quite contentious. Though that is how the establishment side of our current political debates tends to express what is at stake in the current moment. And more than tendentious, it also, I think, is metaphysically insignificant. Our political struggle over the future of the nation state and nationalism, that these struggles are best understood as referenda on what I call the metapolitics of the West. I warned David that the talk would have a kind of egg-heady dimension to it, but I'm confident in my audience. There's a metapolitics in the West, and this is now being rejected in the anti-establishment populist rebellion. So the rising populism that we're seeing throughout the West, of which Trump's shocking electoral success in America is but an instance, it reflects a rejection of this metapolitics, which I would characterize as a metapolitics of disenchantment, a metapolitics of disenchantment. So it's a referenda, and people are rejecting the metapolitics of disenchantment, and they're expressing a desire, what I call the return of the strong gods to public life. So people want the strong gods to come back into public life. So I want to now take some time to lay out what I take to be the metapolitics of disenchantment so that we can sort of set some terms, clarify some terms, and maybe I can persuade you of the accuracy of my thesis, which is that what we're experiencing in Trump is a rejection of disenchantment. Now, the great German sociologist Max Weber anticipated this metapolitics of disenchantment, and he gave a famous address called Science as a Vocation, and in that address, he expressed the view that a clear-thinking modern person should recognize that our scientific age had broken the metaphysical bond between fact and value, the bond between our analytical capacities as intellectuals and the pressing questions of how to live and what to live for. Needless to say, in the first half of the 20th century, Weber's very austere and severe intellectualism did not hold sway in public affairs. In 1914, the strong gods of nationalism drew Europe into a terrible and pointless war. Then, after exhausting themselves, these gods and others roused themselves for still another round of violence and bloodshed, on a global scale this time, and it ended with Europe in ruins. Now, the strong gods discredited themselves in the first half of the 20th century. And after 1945, this is my historical thesis, and after 1945, Weber's notion of disenchantment was adopted by European elites as a positive program, paradoxically, a positive program for cultural renewal. A consensus formed in the West that we could not endure another round of nationalist zealotry, and that therefore the way forward required weakening the powerful loyalties that bind men to their homelands. So we had to understand, disenchant or weaken these powerful loyalties. And in some circles, this consensus also held that communist totalitarianism stemmed from the same dark disease. In this case, a kind of ideological fervor that leads to a blindness to the moral claims of human dignity. And here again, especially in the United States, many assume that the restoration of a more humane way of life in the West would require softening and weakening. Now, in light of this consensus, the immediate post-war period, the steps were taken to disenchant and desacralize public life. The European Coal and Steel Community, foundation of the European Union today, represented an effort to apply the balm of commerce to the wounds that had historically divided Europe. This initiative was a part of a larger and very powerful cultural trend in the post-war era to make strong claims taboo. The popular influence of French existentialism is a case in point. Someone like Albert Camus tried to articulate a humanism that required no authoritative tradition, no authoritative institution, and no authoritative form of life. Now, the aftermath of the civilizational crisis of 1914 to 1945, this imperative of weakening affected everything. And that's the reason why the Second Vatican Council, which met in the early 1960s, was widely interpreted as a liberalizing and secularizing enterprise of what were once authoritative and transcendent dogmas. The actual content of the council documents did not really matter in the end. The church, too, was swept up in the imperative of disenchantment. In the United States, the dominant liberalism of the 1950s cultivated a pragmatic approach and claimed to be post-ideological. I think Daniel Bell wrote a book that published in 1960 titled The End of Ideology. And then, but I think more telling is an episode in my history of my country, and that is in the 1945 Walter Lippmann was a very influential public commentator throughout the interwar years. Really one of the most influential liberal commentators on public affairs between 1920 and 1950. And he published a book called Essays in the Public Philosophy in 1955, and he expressed a concern that liberal democracy becomes vulnerable if it loses touch with deeper metaphysical foundations. In effect, he made a kind of popularized natural law argument for liberal democracy. Interestingly, the book was not well received in the mid-1950s by liberal reviewers. A number of those reviewers recognized that Lippmann's project marked a descent from the post-war consensus about disenchantment. He wanted to re-enchant the rationale for liberal democracy, whereas the consensus one was that all of our public commitments needed to be disenchanted. And in fact, some of the reviewers even suggested that Lippmann's book had authoritarian tendencies, and it was a crypto-fascist book. Now, this disenchanting narrative, or this disenchanting imperative, broadened in 1968. It is forbidden to forbid, that was the slogan of French students rioting the streets in Paris in May 1968. And this paradoxical imperative, it is forbidden to forbid, marks well the trajectory of the post-war era. It meant that everything strong and limiting has to go. We must weaken social authority so that we can live more fully. So it's a kind of, it starts in the post-war era, and originally we got to limit politics so it doesn't become inflamed by the strong gods. And then within a decade or two, this becomes a general cultural imperative. We need to weaken and disenchant all forms of social authority so that human beings have breathing room and can live more full lives, existentially richer lives. Now, I don't need to recount for you tonight the cultural revolutions of the 1960s. We know them well, and we live with their consequences today. What's less acknowledged, I think, is the importance of 1989. Before the fall of the Berlin Wall, the existential threat posed by communism pressured the West to maintain a strong political will, certainly the United States, very much so. We had to steel ourselves to speak forcefully about the virtues of a free society. But after the collapse of the Soviet Union, America and Western Europe relaxed, confident that our way of life had been vindicated by history. As Francis Fukuyama famously pronounced, we have come to the so-called end of history, and wrote a book titled The End of History. You should always beware books titled The End of. Securing a better future, therefore, no longer requires strenuous effort on our part to muster a political will, nor does it need philosophical justification. The project of making the world a better place will be carried forward by global capitalism, which has its own intrinsic momentum. Market forces are going to operate whether we want them to or not. And there's also a legal and bureaucratic apparatus of transnational institutions and structures. And they also have their own logic of expansion and colonization. So the people of Ireland really have no choices to make anymore. Your future is already set for you. And you just have to live your lives and just be docile citizens in a globalizing process that's going to happen whether we want it to or not. So just relax and get as rich as you can. Now, there's an Italian philosopher, his name is Gianni Fattimo, and he's a really great apologist for this end of history approach. It's what I call neoliberalism, and it's a synthesis of different kinds of trends in culture. And he endorses what he calls the destiny of weakening. And we're shifting, he says, from substance to event, and we're going to have a way of thinking about life that shifts from authoritarian modes of thinking to liberating modes of thinking. A present view of a good life, he says, is a kind of quality of lightning. He loves these lightning, weakening images. And he has this notion of the weakening of being. It's a kind of happy unburdening of the West, of its metaphysical baggage. And if this is going to promote tolerance, peace, and freedom, if there are no strong truths, nobody will judge others and limit their freedom. If nothing is worth fighting for, no one will fight. Peace, freedom. And as was the case for ancient figures, Fattimo looks forward to a disenchanted world that encourages us to adopt what he calls a moderate and generous approach to life. So nowadays, it seems to me, after this long period of disenchantment, the imperative disenchantment has worked its way through our culture in the West, the great commandment is not to love our neighbor as ourself. Instead, the first great commandment is to go easy on our neighbor as we go easy on ourselves. The great commandment of our time. Now, this Gianni Fattimo character, he speaks in the patois of postmodern philosophy, and maybe we can write him off as one of those Pomo thinkers and so on. But Larry Summers is a kind of serious guy in the American context, former Secretary of the Treasury, President of Harvard University, former President of Harvard University, and all-around, first-class member of the Davoisie. And he makes a more straightforward approach. It pretty much says the same thing as Fattimo. In a recent essay that he published in Foreign Affairs, which is an American establishment, it doesn't get more establishment than Foreign Affairs, co-authored an essay seeking to defend this global neoliberalism. And it's titled The Fusion of Civilizations, A Case for Global Optimism. And this essay rejects Samuel Huntington, a political philosopher who famously wrote the book The Clash of Civilizations. He rejects Huntington's assumption that we have a native tendency to be loyal to strong beliefs that often clash. Summers assumes that the civilizational differences that characterize us throughout the world, that these can be transcended and sidelined by a global kind of technocratic consensus based on science and technology, and that a stable, rule-based order will evolve to ensure fairness and to protect human rights. And here, too, it seems to me, what Summers envisions is a destiny of moderation and weakening. Instead of the strong gods of traditional culture, the globalized future will be governed by the weak hearth gods, I call them the hearth gods, of health, wealth, and pleasure. And the neoliberal high priests will be medical experts, economists, and celebrity chefs. Now, to a great extent, the weak gods already govern in the United States and in Europe. Establishment, so-called establishment politics, I think, is best understood as promoting and sustaining the general pattern of weakening and the rule of these hearth gods, which are kind of smiling, soft gods rather than strong, harsh gods. And the rising populism of anti-establishment politics represents a revolt against the pattern of weakening. And the reasons for this uprising are no doubt quite multifaceted, complex, and influenced by the unique circumstances that abstain in different countries. You can't say that Donald Trump was elected because of a rejection of the pattern of weakening. There are many different factors involved, but I think it's a deep theme underneath that unifies all the populist rebellions in the West. And so I want to talk about, well, what is that underlying common dynamic? So it seems to me that the ongoing cultural project, ongoing project of cultural deregulation in the West, which I think is only described to the pattern of weakening, that this cultural deregulation resembles economic deregulation. In concert with economic deregulation, cultural deregulation has accelerated since 1989. And it erodes the stable bases for working class and middle class life in the West. And this neoliberalism, which is best, is I think the best word I can come up with for a kind of economic and cultural regime of deregulation. This neoliberalism dissolves the strong elements of traditional societies, the elements that tend to impede the free flow of commerce, identity, and desire. And this may work well for a global elite, but ordinary people increasingly doubt that this cultural regime of deregulation works for them. In the book that John mentioned, Resurrecting the Idea of Christian Society, I try to detail the ways that this is not working. But I don't want to go into all this, and I also try to explain how disenchantment serves the interests of elites, encouraging them to discount the interests of the great majority of citizens of their own countries. But I don't want to go into that, and I may in fact be wrong in many of my details of cultural and political analysis about why this populism is on the rise, but it's becoming clear that a substantial number of voters in the West are rejecting the neoliberal project, which is a cultural as well as an economic one, and it's a project of weakening, deregulation, and disenchantment. And the populist revolt is clearest in calls for renewal of national identity. This is brought into sharp relief by anxieties about mass immigration, especially in Europe. Our political establishments have inherited the post-war imperative of disenchantment. And so we, all of us in this room, are socialized to believe that we have a fundamental moral duty to resist populist calls for more nationalistic policies. We're socialized to believe that in that way is great peril, that the return of the strong gods will bring disaster, and we need to resist that. And so our establishment typically defends diversity and inclusion, and it promises that the world will be more at peace if we affirm multiculturalism rather than go down this path of renewing national identity. And a politician or public figure who stands for something strong, whether it's nationalism or, for that matter, traditional morality, always in the current context gets described as authoritarian. That's the way the metapolitics of disenchantment works. Walter Lippmann was described as an authoritarian in 1955 for appealing to natural law, something strong. So anybody in our politics who appeals to something strong is going to be denounced as an authoritarian of some sort. In Europe, we're warned that we must prevent a return of fascism. In the United States, the bugbear is racism. We have different histories of disaster where the strong gods have done terrible damage. And so we typically focus on them and try to prevent that from happening again. But I've actually heard sophisticated intellectuals offer sincere analysis of today's populism, whether it's Trump or Brexit, in terms of Hitler, Mussolini, and the Ku Klux Klan. This is a sign of how deeply invested our establishments are in the logic of the post-war era and in the imperative of disenchantment. The crises of the 20th century brought by strong gods remain definitive in our minds. And this encourages us to make still further applications of disenchantment, to to try to prevent any kind of backsliding on this project. Now, I'm pessimistic, I must admit, at least in the near term. And I believe that the populist rebellions will intensify along with establishment rebellions against populism. Establishment resistance to populism. Rebellions will increase, and the establishment denunciations of those rebellions will intensify. And this is going to precipitate a series of political crises in the West. In fact, I envision the EU Court of Human Rights declaring a national election invalid because it was motivated by nativist sensibilities and therefore was a violation of human rights. So I predict that there will be some crisis associated with some element of the EU declaring a national election invalid for kind of, you know, because it violates the imperative of disenchantment, the metapolitics. And I think you can see this in the United States with the criticisms of Trump from center-left and center-right in the United States stems from the fact that he also is challenging the metapolitics of disenchantment in the United States. The metapolitics says what you are permitted to say and what you're not permitted to say in order to contest for power. And he violates those rules. You know, political correctness is a particularly exaggerated late version of this rulemaking about who's allowed to speak in the public square. And that's the metapolitics. So in both cases, I think this conflict is going to intensify. And the reason why is because populism, put simply, wishes for a return of the sacred to public life. National heritage is an obvious instance of this sacredness. Yet as I sought to outline above, our political culture is shaped by a pattern of weakening that cannot accommodate a desire for the sacred. The post-war consensus always marshals cultural and political power to condemn the return of the strong guys. And it does so in the strongest possible terms, labeling it racism, xenophobia, fascism, bigotry, and so forth. I think we all know the different tropes that are trotted out to disqualify these challenges, or these challenges and these calls for a return to the sacred. Well, I'm kind of a bit of a loss, I must admit. I'm trying to think this through, and I'm a bit of a loss to really adequately explain my forebodings about the future. So if you'll permit me, I'll make some impressionistic observations of some experiences like that. I was recently in Europe for some discussions, and a young woman from France made an impassioned speech during a discussion of immigration, and it opened my eyes to the deeper issues at stake in populism. She told her listeners that she was middle class and therefore could not afford to live in neighborhoods that have no Muslims, as do the rich French. Rather resentful of that. And so she knows their ways, and that includes a tradition of returning on holidays to Tunisia and Algeria to visit relatives, and that these return visits are much cherished by her Muslim neighbors as opportunities to go home. And she used the Arabic word for home, and I don't remember what it was, but these were cherished opportunities to go home. And her voice wavered at this moment, and she said, "If I lose France, where can I go?" I was just blown away. I cannot imagine a more politically explosive emotion than the fear of losing your home. And I think we underestimate that emotion at our peril. And I cannot imagine a more ineffective response to that than to denounce her as Islamophobic. For this is a weakening trope. And it amounts to a demand that she give up her desire for home. And this can only make her more fearful that France's leadership class will be complicit in her homelessness, thus redoubling her commitment to populism. And you see my fear of this heightening cycle of commitment, which at one level is understandable, denunciations of her anxieties that only sharpens and heightens her worries, and perhaps makes them irrational, makes her more vulnerable to manipulation by demagogues. So you can see, hopefully that helps understand my fear. Another impression, Julia Offie She's an accomplished American journalist, and she writes for various mainstream newspapers and magazines. She immigrated as a young child from Russia with her family to the United States. She writes intelligently on any number of political and cultural issues. I was struck, therefore, by a recent tweet of hers. And it read, this is what it read. Russian government media watchdog blocks all Russian access to YouPorn and Pornhub. Is this the America you want, Donald? This was after his election. Your pushback. This is what this is the great danger America faces. Now, joining Trump to Putin as an anti-liberal authoritarian is now commonplace among journalists and commentators. More telling, however, is the reductio ad absurdum of the pattern of weakening. Has the high moral mission of liberalism really come down to a defense of a global right to unlimited access to pornography? This is where we've come to. Now, of course, it's unwise to read too much into tweets. Very unwise, as anybody who follows the president should recognize. And there are good reasons to worry about illiberalism, both whether it's in the United States or in Russia, for that matter. I mean, illiberalism is always a danger. It's always something we should be guarding against. Nevertheless, Yaffe's habit of mind is widespread, and it dovetails with this imperative of disenchantment and the belief that disenchantment is a kind of happy fate and that any form of moral authority or regulation represents an evil regression back to fascism. A couple of years ago, United Nations Ambassador Samantha Powers sought to counter Vladimir Putin's annexation of Crimea in a symbolic way. She did so by hosting a party for Pussy Riot, a group of performance artists known for staging public orgies and other transgressions that are familiar to us all. They're the aesthetic strategies of disenchantment. These are most of our art since World War II has been devoted to some form of transgression. And so it's part of the aesthetics of disenchantment. And it's widely celebrated by our establishments as progressive. So just as it is forbidden to forbid today, it is also conventional to be unconventional. So you know when the powerful people in government are affirming transgressive art, that it is no longer transgressive, but rather affirmative of the establishment's main metapolitics, which is that of disenchantment. Now, as I said at the outset, I think we're coming to dead ends. Powers obviously is indebted to the post-war consensus that we serve the common good, we serve it in a positive way by weakening the strong guys, by weakening strong norms, and by weakening strong truth claims. Yet this consensus is now telling me that I must choose between pornographic transgression and Putinism. Just as it is telling the young French woman that I mentioned earlier that she must choose between multicultural utopianism and fascism. These are not happy choices in a political culture that frames our most important public questions in these ways is in trouble. We're obviously in trouble if we have to choose between multicultural utopianism and fascism or between pornographic transgression or Putinism. Okay, so our role as Christians in this moment. Now, it seems to me that we are too often trained in what I think of as a kind of anti-metaphysical materialism. Economics is the queen of the sciences in the 21st century. And in this atmosphere, as Christians, we need to break from the post-war consensus. So I think we should refuse to join the conventional disenchanting denunciations of the populist desire for a return of something strong to public life or something sacred to public life. The imperative of weakening has made a great deal fluid and uncertain, leaving us with very little that is solid and trustworthy. It is not good for man to be alone, and it is a sign of health that our societies wish to reclaim, however haltingly, the nation, which is the traditional form of solidarity in the modern West. At the same time, clearly we need to recognize the dangers and perversions that are sure to come with the return of the strong gods. I mean, the establishment attempt to fend this off is not entirely stupid. There is great danger and peril in this political moment. After all, the nation has become an idol in the past, and it can certainly become an idol again. But in meeting this danger, it seems to me, in the 21st century, we need to be careful. As the post-war era ends, as the imperative of disenchantment runs its course, we do not need still more transgressive art or other strategies of leading. The strong gods have to be met with a proper order of love rather than, you know, nth stage disenchantment. We need to meet the dangers of our time with a proper order of love rather than with more disenchantment. Now, to my mind, there are three great covenants that anchor life. And these covenants provide a pattern of strengthening that, taken together, guard against perverse and destructive laws. So it's my sense that we need a restoration of, if you will, the stability of covenant, the trustworthiness of covenant in our time to meet people's desire for something strong, something sacred, something trustworthy, something that won't be sold or bartered away. The most basic and primeval is the domestic covenant of marriage. As that covenant is strengthened, the dangers of populism and other forms of extremism are automatically diminished. Married men do not fill the ranks of paramilitary organizations, nor do they join terrorist cells. And the reason is not just that married men are preoccupied. The covenant of marriage anchors ordinary life in something that is transcendent. It serves as our most intimate and reliable experience of home. And this provides us with a metaphysical ballast that we need to endure the greater fluidity, heterogeneity, and change of modern life, as it is governed by these. So if we want globalization and a liberal social order, we need to have ballast to endure the fluidity and uncertainty that it unleashes. And it's clear to me that the domestic covenant of marriage is really crucial for providing that ballast. And then, of course, the greatest and highest covenant is religious. Our love of God relativizes our civic loyalties by raising our hearts rather than relying upon the post-war imperative of disenchantment. And as many political sages have observed, religious communities put a brake on the idolatry of the nation. The most reliable protection against the false sacralization of the nation, or the ideology of folk, is not multiculturalism or post-national globalism, which I think will fail in the face of people's desire for something sacred. Instead, a love ordered towards the highest good, which is God, will protect us from these false idols. It's basically the Old Testament. Critique and disenchantment do not protect the people of Israel from idolatry. It's only the higher love, the one true God, that will protect them from idolatry. We need a pedagogy of love, not a pedagogy of disenchantment. Now, the third covenant is a civic one, and it expresses a fitting patriotic love of one's cultural patrimony and national heritage. Now, the civic covenant has many layers. It's local, it's associational, it's not just national. But it encourages a solidarity that makes elites accountable to the common good. And as the post-war era's imperative of disenchantment has weakened this civic covenant, our societies have become more divided, elites have become more remote, and also wealthier and more powerful. And this is not a coincidence. Today, a kind of meritocratic mentality regards power as an entitlement of the credentialed. The future of liberal democratic culture, therefore, depends upon the renewal of our civic covenants. For they are the engines of the social trust that is necessary for us to endure the never-ending struggle for political power in any genuine democracy. Multiculturalism only works in empires. For a democracy, it is an impossibility. We have to be united in a common civic love in order to trust each other enough to enter into any kind of genuine political struggle for power. We'll trust our fellow citizens when we lose, and not allow it to descend into civil war. In conclusion, we're made for love, and love is intrinsically strengthening. We are, moreover, social animals, and our impulse to love seeks civic expression. Thus, the imperative of disenchantment and the pattern of weakening can never provide a lasting and satisfactory basis for public life. I think it's always been parasitic upon a pre-existing civic love that it wants to weaken and soften, but that it cannot actually create the conditions for a public life. And after 1945, this pattern of weakening may have made sense. I think that if I were coming of age in the aftermath of World War II, I would have been a patron of disenchantment. And there are times when dispassion plays a proper role. But I think it is now in the 21st century, or shall we say the enduring 20th century, it has become too predominant and it has become too obligatory. In this atmosphere, we're not permitted to express our civic loves, or for that matter, our religious loves, in public, at least not without careful hedging with the weakening tropes of inclusion and diversity and so forth. We're really not permitted to speak any longer about these strong, strengthening loves. And to a great degree, the banishment of love from our politics is creating the populism that presently troubles us. I would argue that one of the major factors in Trump's election is that he represents something strong. He is a voice of loyalty. His acceptance speech at the Republican National Convention did not mention the word freedom. Instead, it was a solidarity speech, not a freedom speech. It was a we speech, not a me speech. Although he always has an element of me with respect to him, but not me in the sense that freedom is a me issue. Give room for me to do my thing. Give room for me to start a company and build a company. Those are good messages, and for most of our politics in the post-war era, for conservatives, those have been winning messages often, the freedom message. But Ted Cruz in his convention speech gave a Reaganite speech, where I think he used the word freedom 100 times, and Trump's speech not at all. So he represents something, he's a symbol of loyalty, strength, commitment to maintain something stable that people can trust. So this banishment from love is creating the populism that presently troubles us, my submission to you tonight. And that, as a result, we should ally ourselves, obviously in a judicious way, with the populist call for the return of something worth loving. And we should try to tutor this love, desire as best we can, because a mere nationalism is not sufficient. It's dangerous, and it's also not humanly sufficient. It needs to be filled out with the other covenants, marriage, if you will, below, the domestic, and then God, the religious covenant above. This is not going to be easy, obviously. Nothing important in public life is easy. But I think we owe it to my young friend in Australia to do our best to bring the 20th century to an end. Thank you.